With every version of Excel that gets released, the way you do charts seems to change. So back in the day, there was a really simple four-step wizard where you chose your chart type, you said where your data was, you set your options, and you said where you wanted to place your chart. Now these days, there's a lot more options available, but the way you do charts has actually been simplified. The most commonly used chart in the workplace is the column chart. What I have on the screen here is a table showing the world's richest people. And from this data, I'm going to produce a column chart. In subsequent videos, I'll show you some of the other charts that you have available. Now, the first thing you need to do before you create any sort of chart is to select the data. Now, what you'll find is that probably a lot of your time will be spent getting your data ready before you produce the chart. And once the data is in place, you can then produce the chart fairly easily. A lot of people set the data up so that all they've got to do is to select the table and then produce the chart. In our case here, we don't actually want this second column showing the company. All we're interested in is the people and their figures. So what I'm going to do is this. I'm going to select the first column, which is the name. I'm then going to hold Control and select these 4 years worth of data. So as you can see, I've excluded the company in the second column. Now from here, there's two ways I can go. I can either choose the Insert tab, and about halfway across the ribbon, you'll find a Charts section showing all the various types of chart available. Now the most common, like I said, is the column chart here. And when I click this, you get lots of options. But there's also things like the line charts here, the pie charts here, there's various tree maps and other types of charts here, and lots of other types of chart for you to explore. Like I say, I'm going to start with the column chart here. Even though it's one type of chart, there's lots of different variations and options available. So for example, do you want to go two-dimensional or three-dimensional? And the first row and the second row here show those options. Do you want to go vertical or do you want to go horizontal? Now what it's actually done here is it's showing the various combinations of column charts and bar charts all in the same gallery. Sticking with the first row for a second, it's asking, do you want to go clustered or stacked? Now clustered means you show the bars side by side, and stacked means one on top of the other. Okay, and there's all sorts of options like that in here. Now to keep things simple, I'm going to choose a simple clustered column. When you create a chart from the Insert tab, it places the chart as an object on the same sheet as where your data is. So as you can see, here's the chart and here's the data right next to it. And if I want to, I can then move this around carefully and place it side by side. With your selected data like this, you can just simply press F11 on the keyboard. This option creates a brand new sheet for you and the chart is full size on the sheet. So as you can see down the bottom, here's chart 4. Here's my original data, and the two things are separate at this point. Whichever method you use, you have the same options available. So if you look at the top here, you'll find there's a new section there called Chart Tools, with two tabs called Design and Format. Now the Design tab has all the tools you need to manipulate your chart. The Format is kind of an extra tab that contains other options for things like word art, or shapes, or lines. So if, for example, you want to put a flashy title at the top, you could use a word art style for that. If you wanted to draw an arrow pointing to something important to highlight something, you can either draw an arrow or maybe you want to circle it or highlight it in some way. And all the tools on the Format tab are there for that reason. So I'm going to concentrate mainly on the Design tab here. You'll also notice in the top right corner here, three buttons. As you can see, because I've got quite a few people in my data and 4 years worth of data for each one, the chart is quite cluttered. So the filter is a simple way to reduce the amount of data on your chart. So when you click on this, it gives you, first of all, your 4 different years that you have available. And secondly, all the people that are on the chart. So if, for example, I just want to compare all of these people for 2 years instead of 4, I could untick these two here. And now it's just showing 2017 and 2018. I click Apply, and you can see that the chart itself has been decluttered. So it's really concentrating on what you want to see at a given time. If I re-show all the years, maybe there's just a handful of people within the chart that I want to compare one against the other. So maybe if I just clear the list and I choose maybe Bill Gates, Jeff Bezos, Mark Zuckerberg. Yes, I'm just ticking 3 people here. Click Apply, and again, it simplifies your chart, and it just shows you the data for those 3 people. So the filter is an extremely handy thing that they've added in. The functionality was always there, but it was a bit harder to achieve than what you see here. Next up, we have the paintbrush, which represents what's called chart styles. Now, what you see here in this gallery corresponds exactly to what you see up on the ribbon at the top of the screen. As you hover over each of these thumbnails, it applies different styling and different options to your chart. It's looking visually different, and all you got to do is one click, and it will change your chart style. At the top of the screen, if you want to get the full gallery displayed, always look for this little button here called More. Okay, it's like a little down arrow with a line above it. And when you click it, it would expand to show the whole gallery. You can just hover over any of these to see a preview before you commit. The third button at the bottom here on the chart itself is the plus sign. And it's referring to what's called chart elements. So when you think about a chart, there's lots of bits that go towards making the chart. There's things like the axis titles or labels, the chart title, data labels or data tables, error bars, grid lines, legends, trend lines. That's for a column chart. What you'll find is for each different type of chart, there's different options available. So if you think about a pie chart, for example, pie charts won't have axes. In fact, pie charts only have 3 elements here rather than the 9 that you see in this list. Now, apart from the plus sign, you can also go to the add chart element at the top, which gives you the same options. And actually, I prefer using the option at the top because when you hover over things like this, you can see the sub options a lot easier. So for example, if I went to axes over here on the plus sign, to see the sub options, you've got to click the little arrow there, and then it only gives you the text options as opposed to the visual representations that you see at the top. So just compare this, what we see here, with what we see when we go to add chart element under axes, and it actually shows you the two options with an icon next door, which is currently saying that these two options are both selected. Primary and vertical axes are both showing. If we go to the axis titles, you'll see that neither the primary horizontal or primary vertical have a label. If you look down the bottom of the chart, you'll see there's people on the bottom, so we don't really need a label for that. But the numbers at the side here, the vertical axis, you probably do want to add a label for that, because what are these numbers representing? Now, what it's actually representing is their net worth in billions of US dollars. Okay, so under primary vertical, we could click on that to display it. Go to the axis title on the side then, delete what's there, and put in net worth, and then billions USD. Okay, next up, we have chart title. Now, the chart title is actually already on the chart. It's just got a generic label there. We can either position it above the chart or overlay it on the chart. So that's just a personal preference. Whichever one you choose, you then just go into there, into the box that says chart title, and just edit the text to say whatever you wanted to say. The text in any of these labels can be edited using normal means. So if I select all the text in the chart title, go back to the home tab, and just maybe increase the font size a bit, change the font color, all those kind of things, it's all editable. Okay, next up, I'm going to go back to the design tab of chart tools, go to add chart element again, and this time we're going to look at data labels. Now, data labels and data table, they're kind of doing the same job in two different ways. So I'm going to go to data labels and hover over each of these options and just watch what's happening on the chart itself. So the first option adds the values halfway up the column. Then we have the inside end, the inside of the base of the column, outside end, and then what's called data callout. It's quite interesting. So the idea with any of these is that if you've got stuff that's quite close in value, having the values actually written above the column or inside the column states it exactly. So if you're trying to compare, you've got exact values to work with. Now, the alternative to data labels, which you see here, is to go to the chart element there and use data table. So you can either have it with or without the legend keys. Whichever one you choose, it adds a little table underneath the chart showing the values. So in effect, it's doing exactly the same job as the data labels. Data labels is actually on the chart itself. Data tables sits underneath. Now, what you'll find with any sort of report or presentation you do is that there's two types of people. You have managers who are simply interested in the bottom line, keep things simple. Did we do better this month than last month? Or in this case, this year versus last year. Then there's the people that work with the data. And quite often, they need to see the details of the data. So for them, having the actual values on the chart itself is a useful addition. Now, other things you can add to your column chart, things like the legend, where do you want to put it? For mine at the moment, it's sitting right down the bottom, but I could position it on the left, at the top, or on the right, or just switch it off if you don't think it's needed. So now, let me give you a quick tour of this design ribbon at the top of the screen. So Quick Layout offers various preset configurations for your chart. So as you hover over each one, you may find that one of these preset layouts is pretty close to what you actually want. So rather than you having to customize everything yourself, you can just probably find one that's reasonably close and then just customize the last couple of things. So obviously we've got the chart styles over here. This is more to do with the layout of the options. So things like, do you want your data labels? Do you want grid lines on? Where do you want your legends? And all of these quick layouts give you those various combinations. The next option is change colors. Now you have two main choices. You can either choose multicolored, or you can choose monochromatic, which is variations of the same color. You can take any of these series here and customize them to any color you like. So to do that, you've got to make sure that you have what you want in focus. So if I click, say, this dark green column here, you'll notice that all three of the dark green columns got selected. So now I could right click and go straight to fill here and choose a different fill color. If you just want to do something special with one particular column and not the entire series, if I click on, say, the yellow one, just like before, it selected all three yellows. But if I click on that first yellow one again, it isolates just that first column. So now if I do something special to this one, so maybe I'll choose the fill again, but maybe this time I'll apply a texture, and let's just maybe do the bubbles there. So as you can see, it's only affected the one column. So any object on a chart, if you right click it, will give you various options to format, and you can also choose some of the options from the context menu here. Okay, moving to the other side of the gallery here, we have what's called switch row and column. Now let me just switch off the data table just to simplify this layout a bit. If you look at the bottom axis, you've got the people's names. If you look at the legend, it's showing the years. If you want to switch this around and plot it by year rather than by person, that's exactly what switch row and column does. So now if you look, it's got the years on the axis and the people in the legend. If you want to go back, you just simply switch row and column again and it toggles back. We have a chart where the data expands constantly. So at the moment we've got years 2015 through to 2018, but next year in 2019, if we've got a new set of data, we'll need to add it in. Now if we look at the original data here, this table has actually been formatted as a table using this format as table option. And when you do this and you choose from one of the options in the gallery, one of the things it does, it adds a little symbol in the bottom right corner to indicate the boundary, the current boundary of your table. Now, if I was to add somebody else to the list here, You'll notice that the table has expanded automatically downwards. So the formatting of the table has continued, the bottom border has moved down, and the symbol that I just mentioned indicating the boundary of your table has also moved down. And if we were to look at the chart over here, or on the chart 4 sheet, you'll notice that somebody else has been added to the chart automatically. So this is one of the benefits of using the Format as Table feature, is that any data that's then added to your table gets included automatically in things like charts. Also things like pivot tables and other features in Excel. Let me just delete this again quickly. So now that symbol has gone back to the original position. Now if you don't use the Format as Table feature, and what you have here is just manually formatted or unformatted data, then what you need to do is expand the range through your chart options. So if that was the case, back on the chart, what you need to do is to choose the Design tab under Chart Tools, then choose Select Data, which takes you back to the original data that you selected for your chart. And let's say that we had 2019 available in column G. What we could then do is to include the new data. That then gets added in automatically. Now, obviously, for this demonstration, it's blank, but if there was data there, that would then be included on the chart. If you don't already, I recommend using that Format as Table feature. Okay, next up, we have the Change Chart Type. This gives you access to every single chart that's available. There's the column chart with all its various options. We then have line charts with all its various options, pie charts, bar charts, area charts, and so on. So if you create a chart and you realize probably this isn't the best type of chart for my data to represent what I'm trying to show, maybe switch to a different type of chart and go with that. Finally, the move chart option here. We're currently working on chart 4, which is where we produced the brand new sheet using F11, and it put the chart full size on that sheet. But if you want to put this chart next to the original data, I might just go back to the original data and get rid of that first chart we created, just so there's space for this one. Then back on chart 4, I'm going to click Move Chart. And the two options you have are, do you want to place the chart on a brand new sheet? And that's actually where it is right now. Or do you want to place the chart as an object in one of the other sheets? And as you can see here, it shows all the other sheets available, and you can choose which one you want to place it in. So let's say we choose the rich list, dollar amounts, click OK, and here's the chart, but next to the original data. You'll notice that the chart 4 sheet has now been deleted because the chart itself has been moved as an object into this sheet. When you have your chart as an object, just be really careful when you want to move it. Because, as I mentioned before, there's lots of elements that go towards making a chart. And if you just go in the middle somewhere and start dragging, it's highly likely that you'll dislodge something. So you might dislodge a column, or a grid line, or a label. So the safest option is always look for your four-headed arrow. That's what you need to move something. And I tend to go straight to the border, the frame of the chart itself, and still with the four-headed arrow, click and drag. That way you're moving the whole object as one unit, and you're not going to accidentally dislodge something from within the chart. Resizing, you can either use the side or the top and bottom handles, but the best ones to use are the corner ones because you can do both at once. If you ever want to move the chart back to its own sheet, you simply go back to Move Chart at the top here and choose New Sheet and give the new sheet a name. So it's the reverse situation to what we did before. So don't be scared of charts. Maybe come up with some data and just produce one of the charts yourself and play around with some of the options. It's pretty easy to set up and pretty easy to customize. That's it for this one.